Welcome to the 2022 Roy Palmer Lecture. Roy died in February 2015, and a little while after, we decided that it'd be a really good idea to set up a series of lectures to honour his work. He was a great friend to many of us, either singers, folklorists, song researchers, all sorts of, social historians, of course, with an enormous output, but he was always willing to share what he knew with others. And so the spirit of this series of lectures, of which this is the seventh, was to enable people to share their own ideas, and they are their own ideas. We never actually tell people what they've got to talk about. And this year, Julia is asking the awkward question, what should we do with folk song music? And I'm looking forward to hearing it. I'll tell you a little bit about Julia, who's been involved in the collection, transcription and analysis of traditional music for, she says, 40 years, but surely it can't be that long. She completed a degree in music before going on to an MA in Folk Life Studies at Leeds and a PhD in folklore from Memorial University of Newfoundland. And she's now a researcher at the University of Sheffield School of Education, studying children's folklore, past and present, including musical play. And of course, she is the organist for the carol singing at the Blue Ball in Worrell.
The best till last.
So, Julia, over to you.
Thank you so much, Martin, and thank you all for coming today. It's a real honour to be asked to give the Roy Palmer Lecture. So I was thinking I'd sit down for the first part of the talk. Are you hearing me okay at the back? Fantastic. So one of the many books that Roy Palmer published during his long and productive career was called The Sound of History. It was concerned with songs of social comment. Like many of Roy's publications, it aimed to demonstrate that traditional songs could shed light on the past and were worthy of consideration as source material by historians. In this lecture, honouring Roy's memory, my aim is to focus on the musical sound of history. What can traditional songs tell us about the musical practices of those who sang them? This is something I call their vernacular musicianship and the sound of the past. So it's 115 years, in case you hadn't noticed that it's an anniversary, since the publication of Cecil Sharp's English Folk Songs, Some Conclusions, a really important reference point in the history of the study of traditional song and its music in England. Sharp's book covers all these areas that you can see on the slide here, if you can see through me. It's a really rich array of musicological topics. We've got scales and modes, rhythmic figures, melodic figures, the singers, the singing, what they think about when they're singing. It's fascinating, as well as the difficulties of studying folk song melody historically. So although this isn't the only treatise on traditional music, it is actually one of the earliest and probably one of the broadest. So really, how much of that informs our knowledge today? How has this legacy been built on, and where can we move forward from some of the conclusions that Sharp made all those years ago? So I just want to pause on this idea of vernacular musicianship and think about that in relationship to the early collectors. It's well known that many of them, the Victorian Edwardian collectors I'm thinking about here in England, were particularly interested in folk songs as music. They saw themselves variously as involved in its discovery, its documentation, its recognition, its revival, according to their various agendas. It's important, though, I think, to highlight that the many of these same collectors spoke about singers that they encountered as musicians. For all their focus was on tunes, they've also noticed the musicianship of the singers that they encountered, and they comment on it. The testimony is really scattered through all kinds of places, the journal articles, the lectures, the correspondence, but we do get some comments. Here's just a small spattering of some of the things that they were saying. And also starting with really someone who isn't always thought about as an early collector, but someone who commented. And he says, The song and the singer seem to be the song seems to be, and the word, ooh, that I've misquoted that, sorry, seem to be inseparable for singers, such as these have a quaint personal style and an unexpected manner of prolonging their best notes. What does that mean? If only he could have recorded. Granger, of course, wrote extensively about singers. Their feeling for rhythmic continuity between one verse and another was just one very specific observation, but he made many. Then Sharp writing in the Musical Times about the extraordinarily beautiful voice of a singer, rich and resonant. And he held on to the last note of the refrain with consummate art, swelling it to a fortissimo and then allowing it to gradually die away into silence. And then we know that Lucy Broad would sort of test their modal knowledge, to sing them a tune that was probably in a mode or a minor scale to see how quickly singers could pick it up. And she said that it didn't matter what it was in, they very quickly picked it up and were able to sing it back to her very easily. And Baring Gould as well says James Parsons, he said, you know, would always correct his transcriptions. You must sing this a bit stronger, he says. And by that he means take it up a semitone or two. He won't let the smallest deviation from what he has to impart. So these were, even then, comments about the musicianship of the singers, but they're scattered, and I think it does well to bring them together sometimes and remind us that we do get these vignettes. Well, as you've heard, my own background's in music too, so I'm going to talk about a bit of musical stuff today. It is notation-based, and I hope that I can, even if you don't read music notation, I can hopefully make that reasonably accessible to you as part of the talk. And I'm going to focus on the three T's, as I'm going to call it. That's not cups of tea, but the letter T. And the first one of the T's is transcription. So the musical tradition we're interested in is essentially, you all know this, an oral one. That's oral with an AU at the beginning and with an O. Musical transmission took place through performance. Singers rarely learnt tunes from the page and rarely wrote down their tunes, although some could and did. We think of the likes of Sam Willett, the baker who sent tune notations to Lucy Broadwood, and Charles Lolly, a bricklayer but also a fiddler, who did likewise for Frank Kidson. Instead, they learnt songs by memorising what they heard other people sing. So the norm was for them to learn the whole package together. You know, you've got a performance, which included words and music and the manner of delivery, and it was all rolled into one. More often than not, then, it was others who came along and documented the songs. At first, it was by the only technology available, which was a pencil and paper. Later, of course, sound technology, and more recently, occasionally, video recording. And we're incredibly fortunate today, aren't we, to have access to so many of those written notations and recordings accessibly online. So many were deliberately produced for the purpose of preservation. But in order to explore what they can tell us about vernacular musicianship and folk song music, we need to know how they were produced and how reliable they are. I'm very pleased that Vic is in the room. He's undertaken this kind of evaluation for Cecil Sharp's music. And we know that Julian Onderdonk has done this for Vaughan Williams. I've done it for James Madison Carpenter. Ultimately, of course, there's still a few that need assessing out there, and we need it for every single one of them because their abilities and competences were all a bit different. So I'm going to focus a bit on written sources. Ruth Crawford Seeger, in her excellent book on the music of American folk song, helpfully distinguishes between two types of written music notation of folk song. The first one she calls dictation, a notation of a song made directly from the singer by ear as they're performing, and transcription, which she reserves for when the notation is made from the sound recording that you can obviously play back several times in order to check it and slow it down and so on. So it's worth noting that we have many, many more music notations made by dictation rather than this transcription from recordings. So what did the dictation process involve for the singer and the collector, and how does that affect the way we can use these notations as historical evidence of traditional singing? Elsewhere, in Steve's book, Folk Song in England, I've brought together some of the testimony of singers and collectors about this whole process, showing how it varied from one collector to another and what we know of the singer's experiences. So today, I want to focus on the practicalities. We know that many of the 19th and early 20th century collectors who used this method had some degree of formal musical training that would have given them skills in music dictation, sight singing, oral analysis, and the ability to hear music that they see written down in their head. Even so, the taking down of tunes in live performance was no mean feat, requiring memory, facility with music notation and its possibilities, and of course a good ear. So my own training is supposed to have equipped me with those skills, even though it really truly was 40 years ago now. So I thought we'd give it a go today and just have a go right here and now. It could all go horribly wrong, but let's give it a try. Okay, I've prepped a singer for us who is Martin, and he's very kindly agreed to sing a short song for us. I'm going to be using a music writing application on the iPad, which is called StaffPad. I've only had it a few weeks. It was a birthday present. StaffPad. So I will get it up now.
S-T-A-F-F.
As in the Yorkshire pronunciation, staff, yeah. Can you see that? Brilliant. You can. It's amazing. Okay. So this allows me to write onto the screen, so you should be able to see what I'm doing. Eek. And I use the Apple Pencil, which you can use with a fairly recent iPad. So I'll be able to share with you what I'm doing. It looks a bit like the early folks on collector's manuscript paper, except that it has this amazing handwriting recognition capability. So it'll render the notation, if it can read it, okay, into a typeset format as we progress. So I'm going to give it a go. Hopefully this won't do all of the rest of the lecture, but I thought we could perhaps spend about 10 minutes or so on this. And I'm just going to bring up a score. So I'll just get my piece of paper, my virtual piece of paper, sorted out. I'm going to put it in a piano playback simply because it's the nicest one of the nicest playback tones. It's the voice one is awful. It sounds like some sort of bad choir. There we go. So I have a score ready. I'm going to move over here so I can listen to Martin.
I am an old man.
never. So here's one we haven't prepared earlier. So let's see, could all go horribly wrong, but thought we'd get Martin to give it a go. And we can see what it's like for him too as a singer. You know, what happens? You know, how is it? Is it nerve-wracking? Do you feel like some of those people
a little bit nervous.
Shaky.
Yeah. A little bit nervous. Okay. It's a big audience.
It is, yes. I didn't bring any beer, I'm afraid, either. That was a big, yeah, okay. Lovely. So I don't know what Martin's going to sing, so do you want him to introduce it and start when you're ready?
This is actually a song from the Baring Gould collection.
We didn't think you were going to do that.
A variant of Cold Haley Night. Like me to start?
Yes, please do. The advice of the Folk Song Society was having a listen to the first verse before you get writing.
My hat is frozen to my head, my feet, my fingers chill and dead, my heart is like a lump of lead. With standing at your window pane, oh, let me in, fair maiden bright. It is a cold and haily night, and I won't go back again. Your dad and mum are fast asleep. The raindrops through the thatching weep. And here against your wall I creep. And standing at your window pane, oh, let me in. Fair maiden bright, it is a cold and haily night, and I won't go back again.
That's fantastic. I'm going to interrupt you there. I think it's just... Yes. because of time and things, I just... So one of the things I'm finding... Sorry, so this is a kind of commentary on the process as well, which we wouldn't have happened at the time. Beautiful song, absolutely beautiful. A hard song for a beginner transcriber in, you know, thing, but... Let's give it a go. One of the hard things I find immediately is to write this down while I'm listening to it, okay, and to try and sort of figure it out. So I just need a moment to kind of get myself ready. Don't know how others in the room are doing it. I'm starting to hear the tune in my head a little bit, which is excellent, which is lovely. But unfortunately, it's got really quite a sort of elastic rhythm to it, and I'm struggling with the time signature, so I'm going to ask Vic and Ian if they have a thought on the time signature.
Well, I think it's fairly free.
So yeah, it is.
The end of lines paused.
Yes.
I mean, it does have a rhythm, but it's one of those rhythms that sort of, you know, pauses and goes on again.
Yes, I'm making it about triple time, really, and I'll be able to demonstrate the app here, which is nice. And I'm going to stick it into sort of a, it's kind of got a modally sound to it, hasn't it? A G minor-y kind of sound, maybe. So I'm making a decision about, well, I'll just stick this into something that fits the stave, but I'm not necessarily going to write it into the key that Martin is actually singing. But it's just a beautiful song, and it's a bit of a distraction, really, listening to the song and thinking, wow, this is gorgeous. Oh, no, I need to write it down. Like a lot of songs, it has a pickup bar, so I'm just going to put that in too. Like this, it's partly to show you the app, which I love. And I'm going to put it into a sort of G minor-ish key signature, because I've sort of cut very imperfect pitch. It's not this key that I don't think Martin's singing in, but it's the one I'm sort of hearing it in, so I'm going to put it in there. So let's just do that. Change the key signature. So we want 2 flats. It's a bit new, this app, as you'll see, so... Okay, so I'm going to try and write down a little bit from memory. And you get to see, it's amazingly how it's reading my writing. Now, also, it has this incredible facility that you rub things out by pressing a bit harder. Isn't that amazing? If Sharp had only had this, eh? Okay, so I think I've got the first line. Should we ask Martin to go back again? Sorry, it's a bit... The performance is not yours, is it, when it's a folk song collector? They take it away from you. Like, oh, I have to write it down. You can see that I couldn't even begin to get the words... And I can't really do the whole song either. Like, I couldn't do all the verses. I'm lucky to get one line from all of this. You see, and I'm a trained musician and I'm struggling. Martin, could we just have one more verse and then I can play what I've got? Otherwise, I think we might spend the whole afternoon on it. I will do it probably later.
My hat is... Oh, I'll drop the key in there. My hat is frozen to my head. My feet, my fingers, chill and dead. My heart is like a lump of lead.
I'm going to stop you there, because it goes on, doesn't it? That's enough. Okay. Carpenter used to do this, but with the dictation of the words. He used to stop and write it down on his typewriter. So I can see that I don't think Sharp could have possibly done this while they were actually singing. I'm doing it really from what I'm remembering Martin sing. But then occasionally I'm thinking, I'm sure he didn't sing it like that last time. So he's got me. There's a fantastic interval here. Da 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 dum.
No.
Dum. It's not, is it? Da da dum. You think he sang that in the end? Oh, let's see if I can just show you here how it works. Something like that. Sing it again, the first line, go on.
My hat is frozen to my head.
Is that it? I'm not going to play this in the end because it'll put Martin off on the pitch, right, because I've not written the same pitch, but I'll play you the first 2 lines when I've got them. The second line, please. If you want to do the first line and go into the second, that'll be lovely.
My hat is frozen to my head. My feet, my fingers.
lingers chill and dead.
Now that's really amazing, isn't it, that note? Wow. Okay, I'm going to stop there because I'm really finding this as a challenge. Okay.
Oh dear.
I know, I said to Martin very confidently, oh, I'd be able to do that. Okay, so I'm going to play you what I got. You ready? Probably be awful. So it's a slightly different key. Okay, so it will be a big change of pitch, but let's see what happens. This is what Sharp lacked. Baring Gould would have loved this because he always needed a piano to go and play it back on. But anyway, this does it, of course, for me. Okay, so I haven't really got the rhythm very well there, so but at least we've got some of the pitches. Okay, thank you so much. Let's give Martin a massive It was a challenging one, wasn't it, I thought? Yeah, it was good.
I tend to go for the pitches before the rhythm.
Yeah, and it's really difficult on staff pad to do that because it doesn't recognise what the notes are unless it's got some sticks on. But in fact, in the hints to collectors also, they said, choose rhythm or melody. And you can sort of see how sensible this advice is. But imagine not even having much of a musical training and trying to do that. So next time you go onto the Vaughan Williams Memorial Library Digital Archive, just think about what they actually did, because it is incredible, isn't it? Okay, so we've done a bit on that, and I've talked a little bit about, you can see how many decisions come in there, how many hostages to fortune there are, you know, and this is not in a nice room, it might be on the roadside, it might be in a pub, it's not necessarily in the most auspicious circumstances. Yes, a cold and hailey night. Exactly. So you can see that there's a backstory to these notations that you see on the page that's sort of hidden, but it's really important to understand that there's something going on here that produced that document that you now see so neatly on your computer screen. And although we may have said, well, God, it would have been so good to have recorded it, but of course they had to wait for the phonograph to be invented, and then it wasn't that easy, like we all take our mobile phones in our back pocket around with us today. And we may complain that it's only one verse, but actually, you know, it was quite an achievement just to get that, let's face it. There's other things about it. Thank goodness the tune repeats more or less from verse to verse, otherwise we'd be completely sunk. Things get left out. Gosh, can I even start to think about his wonderful musicianship? I'm just trying to struggle to get the notes and the rhythm down. So you can sort of see that there were choices being made when it came to this, and then there were just necessities. It was arduous. I don't know how Martin found that. Probably not an experience he'd might like to repeat. But, I mean, for example, Sharp said, well, the hints to collectors, when it was actually revised, they said, don't worry about calling upon the ballad singer to repeat a song many times. I mean, I had to resort to getting to Martin to break it down, you know. And as I said, it might not work. So and Larkham, you know, famously sang Sharp all those variations. And, you know, Sharp said, you know, had him singing the same song again and again, in some cases for nearly an hour at a time to get the thing down. So you can see it was quite a process. So hooray, on comes the audio recording device of various types. It was slow, as we know, to be taken up by the folk song collecting community, but eventually proliferated, especially after World War II. And so we have this huge body of audio recording material. Yet, weirdly, that hasn't been studied very much from the musical angle. And how much of that has been transcribed into notation? So we've sort of got the opposite problem now. You may say, okay, well, we've got a recording. We don't need that notation stuff. We don't need those dots. But of course, a transcription is really helpful. It's a form of visualization as well as preservation. So it's, for example, when you hear a song, you're hearing it in real time. You can't hear it all at once, but you can see it written down as a whole all at once, because seeing is different from listening. And it also enables us to communicate about music. So it's not that the transcription replaces the recording, but it's a complement to it. And the purpose that the transcription was made for will dictate what it looks like to some extent, as well as how good the transcriber is, what they have to transcribe on as well, and so on. So all these things will affect the transcription. At the end of the day, the transcriber still has to use their musical ear in order to make some decisions. So there's always an element of subjectivity. So I want to share some work I did on transcribing from recordings. This was something, a set of transcriptions I did in 1983. And I was studying at Leeds at the time, and I was interested in researching into folk song style, singing style. And through the archive, I was interested in researching, I was lucky enough to have access to the field recordings of Jeanette Dunn, who was another student there at the time. And in sort of 1974 to 76, she'd researched in East Suffolk, and you may know her book, The Fellowship of Song, Popular Singing Traditions in East Suffolk, which was published in 1980. So I decided to focus on the singing of Bob Hart. I'm sure you're all familiar with his wonderful voice and rich recordings. I selected three of his songs, the most sort of ones he'd recorded the most, as it happened in this archive, and compared multiple recordings, including the field recordings of Jeanette Dunn and the topic recordings by Tony Engel that were made in 1972. For anyone who's not familiar with Bob Hart's biography, a tiny pen portrait of him. He was born in 1892 in East Suffolk. He worked in agriculture at first and then went on to the Herring Steam Drifters, where he worked till he was about 19 or 20. And that was where his sort of early sort of singing took place. He fought in the First World War, where his jaw was blown off and had to be extensively rebuilt through an extensive period of hospitalisation. He returned to Suffolk, got married, had a family, and then in tragic circumstances lost his wife and his sons within the space of a few years. He began singing again to cope. He said that quite explicitly. And singing took on a new significance for him and proved a lifeline back into the community in a new role. And he died in 1978, quite a well-known singer, as you know. So he's in his early 80s when these recordings were being made, but his singing is incredibly fresh, I think, and effortless. So the recordings, the songs that I chose were All Jolly Fellows That Follow the Plough, Female Cabin Boy, and The Banks of Sweet Primroses. I'm sure most of you will have heard him sing those at some time or another. I transcribed them in full, in detail, by ear, and sometimes I even did the words phonetically as well. And it took me ages. It was all pre-digitisation. I was doing it on bits of paper. And I was fresh out of a music degree, so I thought I'd try and extend music notation and build on it in order to make a very, very detailed, Percy Grainger-like description of the performance. So obviously I'm biased towards music notation, and music notation itself has quite a lot of bias built into it. So for example, music notation is all about those dots, isn't it? So it's about points of sound. It doesn't really tell you what's happening in between those points of sound. So I had to kind of extend the notation to try and show that a bit. You can do it other ways with graphs and so on. But maths is not my strong point, so I didn't. I also slowed the recordings down to hear them in detail. I won't subject you to that today. It was pre-digital times, as I said, so it also lowered the pitch and this kind of sound. And quite possibly it magnified certain aspects of it, so I'd always try and listen again to the full speed thing. And in the end, you just end up with different sort of levels of transcription and what you can hear at any particular time. Now, Bob's quite a restrained singer, you probably know this. He has a very understated style of delivery. It's similar to the type that Sharp and others have sort of described, a kind of classic singing style. And it's very much in tune with his comments about singing, where he wants the words really to speak for themselves, and he doesn't kind of, he's not histrionic or a very dramatic performer. So what do the transcriptions show about his style? I will share with you what I think they show. It's quite detailed and I won't go into it all. I'll try and just exemplify that. But one of the sort of things that really kind of hit me was that, and it's kind of obvious really, is that he vocalises in such a different way from classical singing style. So that's kind of obvious, but I want to tell you a bit about how when I come to look at that. And I think it's all very much bound up with the way that he pronounces the words. So let's just remind ourselves how it sounds. This is first of all the transcription I made. I'm really sorry it's not digitised, and I know you'll struggle to read it, and it's not a very good picture, so don't worry too much. We will come to bits of that shortly. So let's just have a listen to Bob just singing a couple of verses of the song. And here's a nice easy transcription. You'll like these transcriptions now to get the sound of it.
It was early one morning at the break of the day. The cocks were all crowing, the farmer did say, "Come arise, me good fellows, come arise with a will, for your horses want something their bellies to fill. When 4 o'clock comes, we merrily rise, and into the stable, boys, quickly flies. With rubbing and scrubbing our horses, I vow, we're all jolly fellows that follow the plough. Oh, and sick, okay. It was early what..."
Okay. Sorry not to be able to play all of it. I know it's absolutely outrageous not to listen to the whole song. And, you know, if he was here, I'd feel it was disrespectful actually as well. But I just want to share with you some observations that I've made as a regard to the transcriptions that I did. So basically, one of the things about the transcriptions I made was you'll notice that it looked like the score, an orchestral score. I call this parallel presentation. So each verse gets its own line. And then when I look vertically, I can compare the same point in each song and see how they, you know, how they stack up and whether he's sort of varied it rhythmically or otherwise, depending. So I really like that style of presentation. Unfortunately, machines think that I want to hear it all together, so it's this cacophony when you play it back. But I think, you know, you can hear from it. You don't need a transcription to hear that fluency and control that Bob's got. It's a really measured approach to singing. He breathes very regularly. His phrasing is very regular. He makes a tiny slip. He for a moment is off course and then he comes back again. And there's a real clarity because he wants you to hear the words. So there's a real continuity and flow. His tempo, his speed fluctuates a little, but his volume level is pretty consistent. His pitching is amazingly consistent, just a few semitones between them, and I looked at, you know, sort of maybe a dozen recordings. He keeps pretty much in tune, which indicates his throat is all relaxed, and sometimes the note just sort of goes under pitch a bit, but then he comes back again and it levels up. So it's all very much very easy to listen to. So let's just quickly look at his vocal technique. And this is where I want to contrast it with that of a formally trained singer of Western classical tradition, just to kind of contrast and show you the difference. So if you've ever had singing lessons in classical tradition, you will know that you're taught to sing the greatest proportion of each note to the vowel. Okay? Consonants are delayed. So if I sang the word plough, I'd sing plough, and I'd put the diphthong at the end. Okay, so consonants are delayed. It's not so much like running speech, and then that helps you to articulate to the next note. But Bob, by and large, doesn't always do that. He uses a number of alternatives to prolonging the vowel, and I just want to have a little look at those. So one of the things he does is he hums a lot. So when you slow it down, you become very aware of this. So he hums on M's or N's, often preceded by a short vowel. So he often says N instead of an, or and instead of and. And in stanza three here, he says we meet is how he actually says it. So he's humming through that M, not we meet, okay? And that kind of propels him forwards, because once we get to the M of the word meet, we want to hear the rest of the word eat, so we understand we meet. So there's just the tiniest little bit pushing forwards there, and that note doesn't have its full value in the pulse of the music. It just anticipates into the next bar a little bit. He also, with the humming, when you hum, it goes into your nose. So you're not opening your mouth when you n. You don't use your full mouth. So that means the sound is a bit lighter, it's not strong. So if it's on a weak beat, that's lovely. It sort of supports the actual rhythm itself. So he says, we meet. So just for a moment, we is lighter and then meet is stronger because of that nasalization there. So it's a lovely way of lilting the tune. He uses L's and R's in a similar way. So we hear a lot about plow and bread and breakfast. Almost an extra, whole extra syllable there, and that comes out as a grace note in the music. Okay, and Granger talks about this sort of thing as well. He noticed this when he was listening to his cylinder recordings. And the other thing we also hear is semi-vowels, W's. When is how he says at the beginning of the verse there, so you get a whole extra grace note. Then the opposite effect is when you get a glottal stop, that stops the sound. So he talks about the break of the day. So we got thud, gap, day. So again, this lovely lift on a weak beat into a strong beat. So here's a couple of clips that show that. So the first one is actually, you will hear because it's in, what did I do? No, I think I did do the clips. So this is just this line. The first one is the when, and it's the breakfast we meet. So let's just have a listen to that and see if you can pick up. It's not slowed down though, just.
When 6 o'clock comes to breakfast we meet.
Okay, could you catch it now? So now I've told you about it and you can see it, you're hearing it, whereas you weren't probably thinking about that before and you may not want to be aware, but it is nice to know what it's doing in there. Second one is the glottal stop, the break of the day one.
It was early one morning at the break of the day.
Okay, so you can hear, so that's just one of the sort of minor discoveries that came to me from actually just really listening, and that's what transcription involves, a lot of listening. And I think this is important, this articulation, because it's such a syllabic style of singing, so we can appreciate more about, and back to my old theme again, vernacular musicianship when we listen to these things. And it's really interesting, isn't it, I think, that Sharp himself also picked up on this. The folk singer, he says, is no mean vocalist. He is a past master in the art of welding together words in tune, in enunciating his syllables with great clearness, while maintaining an unbroken stream of melody. And that's how, in Bob Hart's case, he does that unbroken stream of melody thing through humming and everything, rather than prolonging the vowels as you would in classical tradition. So, and just to show you that, just this is what Granger found out about the palau bit. Okay, you've probably had enough of T for transcription. You're doing well. We're on the next T, which is tonality. It's a bit of a preoccupation of mine, but I'll try not to dwell on it too much. But I've just noticed that there's a very sort of dismissive and even hostile attitude growing up amongst people to mode theory of late. And I partly have sympathy with this, but I think there's a bit of baby and bathwater going on here, so I'd like to try and reorientate thinking a bit about. So what do you think about mode theory? You know what this is, don't you? This is all that flattening and sharpening of notes, and it makes it sound a bit peculiar, but we all love those tunes so much. So let's have a quick poll here in the room. What do you think about modal theory in folk song? Let's gauge your responses with a show of hands. Have a look at these statements. Modal theory is a waste of time, and I try not to think about it. It's all Greek to me, but I'm curious what it sounds like. I'm interested in the theory as well as the sound, describing the tunes that I like the sound of. Okay, so who's for number one? It's a complete waste of time and I hate it and I don't want to know. Lovely, we've got a few takers there. Not too many though, I bet you just don't want to admit. Brave, well done. It's all Greek to me, but I am a bit curious about it. How many feel kind of middle ground there? Oh, a lot of you. Okay, that's very interesting. Thank you for sharing that. Now, I'm interested in the theory as well as the sound, and it describes the tunes that I like the sound of. Is anyone interested in modal theory? Well done. Congratulations. That's brilliant as well. Thank you.
Can we have a number four? Seriously?
Go on, Bob.
To me, it's not a theory, it's a fact.
It's a fact. Well, it is a thing. I totally agree. It is a thing. May I come back to that in just a minute? You're absolutely right. There is something there. But what it tends to do is focus us, we're fixated on only a bit of all those tunes because the majority of them are major, or some of them don't actually have a very clear tone of centre anyway. But let's just recap a bit. So you probably all know this, but the unconventional melodic patterns, notes and intervals found in some of the tunes certainly held its sway over Victorian and Edwardian collectors. It don't conform to the standard major and minor scales of classical music, and they came to be interpreted as akin to pre-tonal music and justified by reference to the church modes, that's Aeolian and all that stuff, and the Greek names that make them sound so mysterious. associated with the development of plain song. And of course, Sharp wrote the most extended folk song mode theory essay, but he wasn't the first, actually. And Fleetwood Shepherd is one of the earliest, I think, who wrote about it in relationship to tradition. And he preceded Sharp by 16 years. So I'm interested in looking at that more. So Sharp's classic statement, Vic's done work on this as well, and he actually devotes a quarter of some conclusions to modes, you know, and scales, and the rest of the book is peppered with references to them too, so there's a lot of them going on. So looking back over its content and influence over the last 100 years, and you can really see how its basic ideas have been repeated over and over again, but many of its subtleties and more detailed observations have been neglected, actually. So there are problems with it, and I've been one of the first to sort of point that out. So, you know, is it useful? So you all know that there's major, basically, and then there's the Mixolydian mode. That's where it's like a major scale, but the seventh gets flattened. There's the Dorian mode, which is the flattening of the seventh, but also the third. That makes it sound a bit minor. And then there's the Aeolian, which is the seventh and the third and the sixth, which is a bit harder to detect. So are you worried about being able to pick this up? I bet some of you are, but I bet most of you think, I don't have grade five theory and I don't have GCSE music, so I don't need. So I thought I'd share with you a little song that I've made up, which will help you to hear what they sound like, rather than go into what they look like written down. So this is new, and you're the first ones to hear this. I thought I'd take the tunes of Villikins and his Dinah, the tune, even. We don't know the origin of that, but it's really nice. I'm working on it. But it's a really nice, sort of very tonal sort of tune. So this song's called The Maid of the Mode. As I was a-walking one morning in spring, I heard of a damsel so sweetly did sing. Her cheeks were like roses, her song it was old, when she met with a folk song collector so bold, singing tur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ay. He said, my fond creature, your sevens are rare. If you will oblige me, I'll take down your air. Then out of his knapsack drew notebook and pen, and he notched up a tune as Mixolydian, singing tur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ay. Her voice, it sang out like the sweet nightingale. Said the man, could you sing in the Dorian scale? To flatten her third, the maid then did consent. No, I've got that wrong. Thank you, consent. And into his notebook the melody went, singing tur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ur-a-lay. This maid wrung her hands, saying, I am all undone. Then she flattened her sixth and went Aeolian. Farewell, said the collector, and he left her alone, saying, I've 5,000 others in my notebooks back home, singing tur-a-lay-ur-a-lay-ur-a-lay. Thank you, ahead of Mixolydian Seven, then. She took up his notebooks and tore them in three. Then she plunged the collector into the salt sea. Lie there, said the damsel, and left him for dead. Don't you never come stealing my modern head. Singing to a lie or a lie or a lie. The Maid of the Mode.
Thank you.
So now you'll never struggle to know the modes again. Okay, so I'm going to give that the round number 736 for the seventh, the third, and the sixth. Okay, and I really hope it'll soon be in the canon and the index very soon. Okay, so The modal, as I said, the modal interpretation of folk song has been criticised, and I think what we really need to do is to try and step back from too much of a fixation of the modes and try and do something that's a bit more holistic. I do think we're stuck in 1907 on this one. And we know from recordings as well as the transcriptions that there's a variety of tonalities that traditional singers themselves perceive these differences. It is a thing, there are those changes going on, but the way we understand them is what we need to look at. So I just very briefly would like to propose that we think about these not in terms of scales, but in terms of singing style, okay? So this means that it's not the scale of the tune that we need to do. We can look at tonality, and that I mean whether it's major or minor or modal or somewhere in the middle, as an attribute of the singer's musicianship, something they do in performance. They may have it the same way every time, or they may not. But we can look at that then and we can say, oh, that's interesting. In this song, they sing this way. In this song, they sing another way. In this performance, they sing this way. But in it, it's got that idea of flexibility. So we can still see those notes being changed, but we don't have to say, label it this way or that way. And that was it, you know, back in 1967, is it? I can't remember now, folk song in England. And A.R. Lloyd was saying, everyone's a bit fixated on this. It doesn't tell us anything to say it's this or that mode. But if we can say it in terms of musicianship of a singer, their delivery, they are flexible with their way they use keys or they're not, then we're saying something that means something. It's a productive way to think about it. And it's inclusive. It uses it, it means we can look at all tunes. It means we can look in a local area and say, oh, this is interesting. Here in Lou Trenchard, they're very keen on the Dorian mode, or not the Dorian mode, but they're keen on flattening their sixth or whatever it is. Or that's interesting. This singer learnt it this way, but this singer who learnt it from them doesn't do that. So again, we're getting a, you know, much more kind of useful insight into traditional singing style. And I think there's lots to explore there. And that flexibility with regards to the modes, we know that singers were flexible, but I think it's just really interesting. I've been fascinated by this quotation from Fleetwood Shepherd, where he talks about the way in which musicians sang Christians Awake. And when they sang it, he says he's in West Yorkshire, so he's talking about the fact that they sing it at Christmas everywhere. It's sort of their national hymn. And he said, there's a place in this tune when it has a flattened seventh, basically, and or actually sharpened seventh, because it makes a perfect cadence, which establishes the key in conventional music. But he says, when they're not in church, they sing that with a flat seventh. But when they're in the chapel or the church, they sing it with a sharp seventh. So they were actually kind of had an adaptive musicality. Also, we know this about Joseph Taylor, for example, as well. So there was a flexibility, and when they were kind of away from an accompaniment, it didn't have to conform to any of the musical rules, they were just singing it unaccompanied, they could have that kind of flexibility in there. So let's build into flexibility into our understandings of those particular things. Okay, I'm losing time, so I'm going to skip on a little bit as well. Oh yeah, that's right, I remember now. I never finished updating my talk on the computer, so I'm back to a piece of paper now. So, what I'd like to do is go to the final T. If I can find it in my notes. Oh yes. Transmission. That's a bit of a cheat word, actually, because it covers all that comparative and history of tunes stuff. It also covers that whole thing about why do tunes sound alike and the resemblance between tunes. So for my final set of examples, I want to whisk you off to Newfoundland. Okay, as you all know, although I didn't know this, I had to look it up when I went there, it's an island off the east coast of Canada, and it's roughly the same size as England and Wales together, but it has the population roughly of Sheffield, which is about 500,000. Okay, so I want to use a song called The Moonshine Can, which I was lucky enough to study in Newfoundland in the 1980s, and I undertook some field work on the Great Northern Peninsula. I've forgotten to put the map, I think, in this PowerPoint. I remember now. Oops, that's yes, scale. Let's go to this one here. Never mind. Newfoundland looks like the profile of a hare, if you've ever seen it. Okay, so the Great Northern Peninsula is the ear of the hare, and I did field work at the tip of the Northern Peninsula. Okay, I was there just after Christmas and I encountered a song called the Moonshine Song or the Moonshine Can. And it was a locally composed song based on a real historical incident, which I later ascertained had taken place in this community, which was called Goose Cove, around 1920. And it happened to a local man there who then made up the song, who was called Pat Troy. He wasn't particularly a singer, but he was pretty sore that he'd been informed on for making moonshine by a local in the community. And he made up the song, I think, really to kind of draw attention to this little historical fact and also to kind of finger the informer. He doesn't actually say who he is, but he kind of hints a lot in the song. And then also thank everybody who helped him pay off the fine. Okay. It also spread the recipe of moonshine making to lots of people in Newfoundland as well. So it is, we're back to Roy Palmer. It's a song of social comment. It was one of those sort of libel type songs, which we don't have so much study of in this country, but in Newfoundland they're quite plentiful. So my first encounter with the song went something like this. It was sung by a man called Tom Sexton, who's about 60 at the time. This was in 1985 and he lived in Goose Cove. And I don't know if you can quite hear, I haven't put a transcription up, but at the beginning the accent may defeat you, but somebody is saying to him, Tom says, I don't know if it's any good for me to try the moonshine can. And somebody says, try it now. And it's a really good example of coaxing, which is a bit of a ritual around singing there. And it's, oh, I don't think I'm going to get all the words. Yeah, try it now. So you hear that at the beginning, and then we'll just hear a bit of the song going on from there.
Perhaps you want to know his name is Avery Young Frank. His name is Avery Young Frank, but why do you may understand? He is one half a library cat right off in Newfoundland. Norton, Owen, no crazy.
So then he had a bit of a lapse of memory, but he did get it in the end. Of course, it took him so long to be coaxed into singing the song that then I was right at the end of my recording and I needed to turn the tape over. And, you know, it was disastrous. I had to go back in May to pick it up again. But I did get the song and I also got a few other versions. And it had 20 verses in it. So obviously I'm not going to play all those. But it's partly satirical about the incident and what happened. It's partly what we call a moniker song. It was the names of all the people who contributed to his fine, I think, by way of thanking them. He would say, you know, so come all ye, so here's a health to so and so and here's a health to so and so. And it was a hint as to who'd done the deed. So it's interesting. I think there's quite a few different versions then spread around Newfoundland. We've probably got about, I think I went back to St John's and there's an archive of stuff at Memorial University Folklore and Language Archive, Munthla. And there were numerous recordings of it there. So I was able to hear a version that was collected by Kenneth Peacock in 1960. So it was 25 years after, sorry, so this is sort of 25 years earlier than the one I did. I hope it won't be quite as loud. I don't know why the thing isn't responding to the sound. But what I'd like you to think about when you hear this recording, and it should be only a few verses, is it the same tune as Goose Cove or is it different?
Come all my friends and comrades, come listen unto me. The well-doing farmer, you see how they serve me. The well-doing farmer, good people all around. For jealousy could not agree, we put our whiskey down. On Easter Sunday morning, the June night came he said. Soon as McGee got the news, he did come down to me. He did come down to me, my boys, and put me on a stand. Saying that there is a big kick-off about the moonshine can. The next one.
Okay, quick vote. So we're going to do it in the way they do it at the opticians, okay? Same? different or not much in it. Does it feel like the same tune as Tom Sexton? No, okay. Different. Okay, brilliant. Not much in it? Okay, interesting. Because what we're talking about is perception. So difficult when the words are very similar. I know you've hardly heard, had the chance to hear, but it's very difficult, isn't it, to sort of decide is that the same tune or not. But this is one of the problems with this whole area of study, is deciding, well, what is the same tune or not? Okay, I've got one more version I would like to play you. I've gone over time slightly. Is it okay to go on for 5 more minutes?
Yeah, go for it.
You're okay with that? Thank you, if you want to go. I understand. So I just want to let you know that in sort of the 1950s, a wonderful Burlives type of folk singer came to Newfoundland. He was called Omar Blondell. He was Canadian, came from Saskatchewan, I think. He was classically trained, but wow, did he ever kick off the folk song revival in Newfoundland. Okay, he had a radio program and used to do gigs out around the bay, as they say. And during one of those, he came across the Mooshanka and someone else singing the song. And he thought, wow, this is brilliant. So he learned it himself, and then he sang it on his radio program to people in Newfoundland, who then learned it from him, who then sang it locally again. So it went the whole complete circle. So there is this sort of, as we have in this country too, the interaction between different contexts of performance. I'm so sorry, this is so loud. I hope this won't deafen you. It probably will, but let's give it a go. I won't play too much of it. Get it up. Here we go.
Moonshine drinkers, and ye will quickly see the work of the bold informers and the way they serve at me. I'll tell of the bold informers who have lately been around. They jealously could not agree, they've put me moonshine down. It'd been on Easter Sunday morn when down the road I see old Mickey waving both his arms and came straight for me. He waved his arms and called them out as down the road he ran, saying, "Pat me by, there's an awful kick about your moonshine pan."
Okay, so the same question. Is that the same as Goose Cove, the first one? Is it the same as the second one? Or is it different, or is there not much in it? So let's compare it. Let's just compare it with the second one. Okay, so is that the same as the previous one? Who thinks that? Okay, lovely. Thank you very much. Who thinks it's different from the previous one? Lovely. It's not quite, don't know. And then who thinks it is, there's not much in it, they're pretty similar? Okay, lovely. Okay, not so many people thinking that. All right, so then this, if we've done that by ear, now we're going to do it by sight. I'm afraid I didn't have time to put this in parallel presentation, so you'll have to kind of join the dots together. But here are transcriptions of all the tunes. All right, so Tom is, to my mind anyway, my perception, completely different tune. It's a bouncy 680, da 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 da, and that's in the community of origin. That's the only place in Newfoundland that that song is sung to that tune. Why? Haven't been able to find out. And there was me merrily thinking I could do some tune history. The people locally don't even know. Pat Troy, the songmaker, was already dead. Tom Sexton is of two generations down. I was never able to find out. And I took them all these recordings and said, which one was it? What was the one that Pat Troy sang? Nobody. Well, I got different answers. It was really interesting. So perception is quite a difficult thing to get into. Joshua Osborne, the one that was collected by Peacock in 1960. It's quite a sort of march type of tune, so I think it's quite distinct rhythmically as well as in terms of pitch. Omar Blondell, you can now see that he's really changed it. It's basically the same tune, but he's altered it, so he does this triple C thing at the beginning. So you don't have that falling phrase that's more traditional. So we altered it, but I'd say it's basically the same tune. And the reason I'm telling you all this is I'm telling you the reason why these songs aren't in the Roud Index, these tunes, because it's so difficult to get intellectual control of these materials, these tunes, because of the difference in perception, because they're a bit like each other here and not here. And because even when we try and unravel something in a more delimited geographical context where we think people might be able to explain the differences and how they perceive them, it's very, very difficult to get to the bottom of it. but I think we need to do it, and I think we need to have a try. So there's been scholarship to try this, but we haven't cracked this nut, and I don't have, to mix my metaphors, a silver bullet to do it, but I do think it'd be really good to try and do this. We've got to start somewhere. So we need a manifesto, I think, just to finish and to say, I think we should study the music of folk song. I think we should. I know it looks a bit dry and academic. I know it goes into a lot of detail. I know I probably sound a bit nerdy, but actually, I think it's nothing to be ashamed of. I think we should be curious about this singing. Hopefully it won't spoil your appreciation of traditional singing, but I do think it's a really important topic, and we mustn't dis intellectual scholarship, which tries really hard to get in there and understand it. And I think sometimes there is a bit of a tendency, what would Bob Hart have thought about that, you play the, sort of that kind of approach. So I really want to fly the flag here for being curious about the music of folk song. Okay. And yes, we've got some incredible resources. Yes, we need billions of tunes transcribing that are there only in audio formats. We've got to somehow get tunes into the Raoud Index and start thinking about tune identity. We've got to find out what the approaches to transcription were of all those people. But, there's another generation coming up, and I think if we can produce some sort of infrastructure for research, then that would be the way forward. So I'm always a bit of an optimist. We've got computational things to help us as well. So I'm just throwing those things out there as something that I think all of these things that were thought about before are of interest. I think we could move on in the modes department, though, and just broaden our scope to tonality. But hopefully in so doing, we will get much closer to vernacular musicianship and deepen our appreciation of this incredible repertoire that we all know and love so much. Thank you all so much for your attention today and bearing with all the recordings and your participation. It's been great.
Thank you very much, Julia. That was so interesting. And that's me saying it from a position I don't really understand.
It was understandable.
There's a lot to think about. We've got time for a couple of questions, I think. Would anyone like to ask anything?
The old collectors, 100 years ago, how much do you think what they interpreted and wrote down was affected by their own views on music and what their motives were for collecting it? So, for instance, if they were doing it so they could make an arrangement for it to sell, they might want to actually make it go into a mode when it wasn't really, just so they can sell it to the churches and the seniors.
100%. I think the purpose of transcription, what we think that it's being made for, was absolutely relevant and key, really, sorry, no pun intended, to what they did with the transcription. And Vic's undertaken work, others have done similarly, to show that when it was published, many of the, I think this is right, Vic, correct me if not, but there was a tendency to prefer modal tunes. But whether it actually then did affect the transcription part as distinct from making it, tidying it up for publication, for sale, that's a harder thing to judge. What I think it tends to be is that, of course, where you have one stanza only, but you maybe had a singer who would have been more flexible, do we think that some of the collectors would have, I think I'll put in the flattened seventh because I prefer that version, or that's the one that sort of stuck with them. Now, when we look in more detail at particularly Sharp's notations, and I've only really looked at the fair copies, actually, I've never delved into the rough copies, but I think he did try and show where there was more flexibility. I think there is more authenticity, if you like, to that document. I think he tried to do that, but obviously maybe for certain publication, I think he also tries to show in publication, actually, but whether others did that without sound recording, we're probably never going to know. But Sharp at least was, I think, quite upfront about the fact that most of it is major. He did say that, but there is more of a bias perhaps in what he then wanted to publish, both in the journal and in terms of arrangements for schools and so on. Because, well, like us, they like that sound. It was exotic, it was different.
Is the original pitch significant?
I think it can be. Again, it all links back to, well, what do we want to find out? It's significant to me, as I'm fascinated by traditional singing. So, yeah, I think it is. And it's very difficult when you want to compare transcriptions. So here, I've put them all in the same key. But, of course, if I wanted to know more about these individual people as singers, I might well want to put them in the original pitch. And, well, did Tom Sexton really sing that song at the same pitch every single time? I think it's fascinating that in an unaccompanied tradition, a singer will often pitch the song in roughly the same area each time. I think it's interesting, there's some testimony from some of Sharp's singers, from Sharp about his singers saying, oh, they got sharper and sharper and sharper through the performance. With our recordings, we can test that out. Bob Hart didn't. He stayed in pitch beautifully. And so again, we learn something then about that person as a singer and their skill, actually, and their artistry. So I think it just depends if you're interested in that, yes.
Sharp tended to publish his tunes higher than they were actually sung, when we could get to recordings, like four notes higher. So a tune, it's basically what would fit on the treble clef. But I think you could think that a lot of the singers were singing about four steps low.
Yes. Well, again, if you think about the circumstances of transcription, imagine me having to write all the ledger lines, if you're familiar with music, to get to those notes if you put it a pitch. I think Percy Grainger probably did. He had a pitch pipe or something and might have played on the recordings. I'm not quite sure. I meant to bring my tuning fork to show you. But so I think he certainly wrote about the need to do that in some of the, with the phonograph. But I think it is interesting, but it's just about, it's not necessarily bad. It's not like they kept it from us. It's just, they just didn't have the resource to do what we might do now. I think there's a bit of bias, of course, in what they did. All historical evidence is biased, and we need to acknowledge that. But some of it was just more about what it was possible to do with the resources that they had.
Gentleman there in the greenish shirt.
I'm interested in collecting today, because in those notes that you gave out from Cecil Sharp, it obviously comes across as a very class society, where he was well above the singers, and if he wanted it again, he said, yes, sir, I'll do it again. But today, in a different society, I don't think the singer will be so amenable to doing it numbers of times. So I wonder, I really don't know how much collecting is done this day, but it must have an effect, the change in class, I should think.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's several things in the scenario described, because now today we've just got that handy little thing in our back pocket or our handbag, or singing to my phone or whatever. So we don't, the repetition part takes place with the recording now and not in the actual encounter. So I think that's the first boon for us today. It's really brilliant. We know that many singers in the room and elsewhere will have been totally familiar with being recorded. They're pros at it. They'll probably tell me how to switch it on and, I'm singing in C major, Julia. Okay, can you just get that done, So it becomes potentially much more of a collaborative, co-constructed kind of situation, or participatory, I think, now. And of course, there's much more informality about it. Although, I'm sure some people look at me and think, it's that academic from the university again. I'm not sure what they made of me in Goose Coat, for example. Okay.
George?
Did anybody ever ask any of these the source singers why they sung the way they did and when it was a bit different what most people played on the parlour piano?
I think they offered comments, but I'm not sure that there was any kind of move to make a question sheet that said, oh yes, let's ask them all. Only that example of Lucy Broad was singing that, sort of testing them on, can they pick up this modal tune? I'll just sing it, let's see if they can then sing it back to me. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether Percy Grainger might have. They don't tend to put in their own questions. They, as far as I can recall off the top of my head, but where there is a soundbite from a singer, as it were, saying, oh, I like it like this, or, there are certainly, Baring Gould certainly says things like that, Grainger, and it's those sort of scattered remarks that are there. But whether they were volunteered or whether they were, one would like to think that maybe there was some discussion about music, but it doesn't seem that way. It might have been that they were volunteered. Yeah, don't know. Good question.
Derek?
I just wondered if there was very much overlap between the sort of the singers that were recorded pen and paper and who were perhaps of a sufficient age that was still then being recorded. I mean, Harry Cox is an example from being recorded in the, you know, notation in the 20s from E.J. Moiran, and then of course recorded in the 30s and in the 50s. And whether anybody's done a comparison of the tune notations and the transcription from the recordings. The Copper family is not necessarily the same Coppers, but the same family tradition.
And intergenerational, yeah.
You know, to what extent. Of course, we do have the Granger phonograph. But I just wonder to what extent there are...
I really think this is the way we should be going with some of the research that we do, that it would be so productive to be able to compare across generations, or based in a local community or region or whatever. And as you say, to make use, we need to slice our cake differently than perhaps we do. I think that would, as far as I know, no one's done that. I'm hoping that someone will ask me to do it, because I'd love to do that. I need another lifetime to do it, but it would be fascinating. And you're right, then we might well be able to. And also, it means that we have not a static picture of a singer's musicianship, but something... Over time, the only thing I can think of that would be slightly similar was the work that Herschel Gower and James Porter did about Jeannie Robertson, and how her style and delivery developed over time, and what it became like when she became more of a performer in the folk revival and at festivals. Yeah, I'm here to be employed in that.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Julia. I think... we need to get that manifesto written up and get it out there, and let's see what we can do about it.
Definitely. Thank you so much.
And thank you for talking to us today. And good luck.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.